Ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to speak a smaller topic now, which we have done with eczema laser. It's a recipe LASIK. You know, you have heard today a lot of solutions in presbyopia, and this is now done on the anterior front of the eye, on the cornea, not on the lens, not on the ciliary body, not on the pupil. You see, it is a dream for everybody to have no glasses when you get older than 40 years, and you need no artificial lenses when you get a cataract. And this, there we have heard a solution-like idea today. And here it's a history of the corneal presbyopia. That was the first point where we looked for a presbyopic correction. That is the first, you see, it was 1991. It was the first three people who have done, the German Till Anschütz and the Italian Paolo Vincinghera and Giorgio Nisola. It was done with an eczema laser. You see it here on the right side, and you see this umbrella-like hole. And this umbrella-like hole, this was turning around this instrument was moving on the cornea, and about this umbrella-like hole, the eczema laser touched the cornea. And the idea was to have like a sectoral ablation, like you have a bifocal glass. Bifocal glass, you have it on the nose and you read, and you can read it till about 40 centimeters, and this was the idea to develop an instrument like that. But the results was tremendous, tremendous faults, because the people had a monocular diplopia and was very unlucky about that. And after that, kind of ablation was dead, because it was only a case for different topics on heuristic topics. They paid a lot of money. The next was Luis Ruiz from Bausch & Lomb, concentric central near zone. That's the idea which we follow now as well. Or Blauberg inferior off-center ablation or concentric peripheral near zone. You see, the approaches for the presbyopia correction, we know it at the moment, are the multifocal IOL, coming more and more accommodative IOL. It is coming better, and that we have heard this morning in this very, very good topics, the ADOF IOL, which we have with the pharmaceutical approaches. There were some scleral implants, scleral expansion, especially done in Japan. Small diameter corneal inlay, it is very modern at the moment. There are different companies looking for that. The camera vision or rainbow, monovision, multifocal PRK, that the eczemalation or multifocal LASIK with a Presbymax for different companies. Central steep area, which we have done with a femtosecond laser from Bausch & Lomb. It's a femtosecond intracore procedure, first done was from Luis Ruiz in Bogota, and then the aspheric PRK laser, the so-called laser blended vision. The monovision LASIK was done, that idea where you thought, okay, we treat only one eye, the monofocal treatment only for one eye, especially for the non-dominant eye. The non-dominant eye was correcting for near, and the dominant eye for the far vision. The best corrected option maybe, and it could be an aspheric ablation. With the aspheric ablation, there it could be possible to have like an ADOF similar ablation. But for more than 1.5 diopter difference, you can get binocular problems, and that was also a point which we heard from you from Irkutsk. Here the approaches for near vision enhancement, the general concept is central near with a peripheral distant correction. Also Louis Ruiz and Bruce Jackson with the Vizix machine in 2001. You see 1991 only the excimer laser, now the LASIK 2001, 10 years later, and today in 2018 we are looking always for a right technique to do the presbyopia. And Franco Bartoli from Italy with a wavefront guided PRK. Sometimes all this denoted as presby LASIK. Here's the presby Max from Schwind. The critical point is the near area, how small the near area could be, because more smaller the near area, we have heard it in the meiosis topic this morning, more better could be the EDOF and could be maybe the presbyopic effect. You see the distance area and the near area and an intermediate area. It is the Schwind technique with the presby Max, and you see the multifocal LASIK approach, a bilateral multifocal ablation. It was a multifocality tries to reach a binocular vision for far and near. And at the beginning, they did not an aspheric ablation, they did just a normal ablation. So after that, they had an aspheric ablation. It was a presby Max hybrid. It was an overlying of the different techniques like the laser blended vision. And you see the negative point is it could be a decreased contrast sensitivity and maybe a night driving difficulties. Here you see the SuperCore Technolas system. The system, the technique, the idea is always the same, a near area as a non-aspheric ablation or with aspheric ablation, and the Technolas had a non-aspheric ablation. And for this non-aspheric ablation, that was the bad point in the future. They had difficulties in looking far away, but they have reading was quite good. And so the SuperCore technique was fallen out. You see the near area, it's a bigger near area for about 2 diopters. And the point is how big is the near area, how high could be the EDOF procedure. Here you see that the central steep area for near vision for patients more than 40 years of age. Near addition 1 till 2.5 diopters, bilateral procedure, prolonged healing time up till 3 months. And that is especially for all the cases in the hypoopia, you need that you can I talk to you later on. You have a longer healing time, especially to the myopic patients. A non-aspheric ablation, and that was the dead point for the Technolas SuperCore technique. It was pupil dependent, and the centration was very critical because it was not an aspheric ablation. Here you see the hypoopia presbyo, and on the right up, the myopia presbyopia. SuperCore. There is a CE marked European multicenter study, and that is the binocular and uncorrected visual acuity. And you can see preoperative and 6 months, and the uncorrected distance is not so good. The uncorrected near visual acuity is much better than the uncorrected distance visual acuity. The press beyond is another technique from Zeiss. Main point is always the near vision in the center and the far vision in the periphery as like an umbrella. And you see that the different parts were coming together, they're overlying, and that's the so-called blend zone. The one eye is looking for distance, the other eye is looking for the near, but they are overlying in the intermediate zone, and though the both eyes can read between about 60 centimeters till 1 meter. Laser therapy for patients aged between 40 and 60, and that is the other point. All these techniques are between 40 and 60 years. Bilateral simultaneous treatment, increase of depth of focus, enhance the acceptance to the monovision, available for myopics and hypoopics with and without astigmatism. Retreatments are possible. Just opposite to the supracoroidal, there were the retreatments not possible. Treatment range from plus 4 to minus 6. That's the same as you know it from the Schwind. And enhancing the natural bullet of shape. But the difficulties is always the contrast, contrast sensitivity and night vision problems. It's an increased depth of field to enlarge the visual acuity in near up till 1.5 diopters and intermediate, and increased spherical aberration. And that is the other point, with the increase of depth of field, you have an increase in the spherical aberration without, they say, without subjective side effects, but you see they have halo, glare, and a reduced visual acuity. There could be a positive dysphotopsy, no reversibility, enhancement possible, but difficult. But it is possible, limited to 1.5 diopters near, at for the non-dominant eye. Intracore overview, that is the femtosecond presbyopic technique from Bausch & Lomb. These are five femtosecond rings about, around the pupil, incisions to induce biomechanical changes. The deepness of the ring has to go up till 80 to 90% of the corneal thickness, because in these points you can correct some scars, and then the regression wouldn't be so strong. That is a detection which was done from Professor Jean in Tübingen. It's a monocular correction of hyperopic eyes and the central corneal steeping. The main difficult point, therefore it is out of the area now, is the risk of keratoconus. It is from my country, it is not recommended, and the clinical data are preliminary. This was mainly doing this technique was Luis Ruiz from Bogota. General disadvantages of the bifocal cornea: you have two pictures at the retina, one for far, one for near. You have one picture is sharp, the other is blurry, or both are blurry. Loss of contrast, light scattering for transition zones. And now we have in the presby LASIK done two groups, a myopic group and a hyperopic group. And you can see here mean pre-spherical equivalent minus 3.4 plus minus 2.47 diopters, and postoperatively for the dominant eye after 6 months minus 0.17, and for the non-dominant eye you have to go less myopic, it is minus 0.19. So you can read with the non-dominant eye and you can look far away with the dominant eye. The hyperopic population you see here means spherical equivalent plus 1.68 plus minus 0.82 diopters. That is the sum of the spherical and the cylindric. And postoperatively after 6 months, minus 0.11. And it's an overcorrection for the non-dominant eye to minus 0.95. Here you see the age distribution for this presby LASIK technique. And it is mainly between 40 years and 60 or 59. After that, you have to look for other corrections like lens surgery. Stability in the myopic group, that seems for the corneal correction quite good. It is quite stable. And for the hyperopic group, there is a regression up till 1 year for about 0.5 diopters. And here you can see the difference between these two groups, myopic and hyperopic. Myopic is much more reliable than the hyperopic. The hyperopic is much more difficult and you have more regressions. Predictability in the myopic group, you can see you can go up till 7-8 diopters, the predictability is quite good. And for the hypoopia, the regression, the undercorrection starts higher than 3-4 diopters. Therefore, we have the limit in correcting hypoopia up till 4 diopters. The safety, the corrected distance visual acuity, you can see for the myopics in the green and for the hypoopics in the red line. You see the line gaining is 35% in the hypoopia. The green line is much better. It is absolutely you see it after 1 month, and in the hypoopia that must come the result. The monocular, the cumulative uncorrected near visual acuity for the myopia and the hypoopia, you can see here it's always the same. Jager 1 or better in the myopic group, much weaker than in the hypoopic group. The comparison between binocular near with binocular distance uncorrected visual acuity in the myopic group, you can see here, is Jager 1 or better with near visual acuity to 2016 or 2020. Best corrected visual, uncorrected visual acuity, it is 61% in the myopic group, and in the hypoopic group, it seems to be better, it is 74%. Complications, we had an incorrect flap, a decentration, monocular diplopy, dry eye regression, especially in hypoopic eyes. And there are difficulties of anisochrony for an isometropy of more than 1.5 diopters. And before you start a Presby LASIK procedure, you have to look which is the dominant and the non-dominant eye. Give the patients some soft contact lenses. Let them wear for about 4 to 5 hours or for 2 days. And then they say, okay, I'm fine. With the reading, I'm fine with looking far away. In summary, all the Presby LASIK approaches are far from being perfect. In comparison of all these methods, the laser-blended vision seems to be the procedure with at least the amount of the less side effects. The contrast sensitivity in laser-blended vision is not reduced because of the spheric ablation profile. But the contrast sensitivity in all these Presby LASIK procedures is not reduced. The intracorneal procedure probably could have better results, but this intracorneal procedure we have seen, or this corneal procedure with the femtosecond laser, it was not good. But the other, the implants, there I think we could have better result. Thank you for your kind attention.